The Man in Line with Andy Wint.
First things first, are the goats still there at the dune on the tram lines? Now, this is serious. Goats were reported on the tram lines at the dune about 20 minutes ago, so perhaps they're yours. A motion of no confidence in the Chief Minister is being brought to the House of Keys next week. But if not Alfred Cannon, who do you think should lead the Isle of Man in the next general election in 2026? Chris Thomas has thrown his hat into the ring. Any thoughts on that? Text, email, call, WhatsApp, and Mark's with us first today. Hi, Mark.
Hi, Andy. Funny enough, I've heard lots and lots about goats at the moment. Are they wild goats or are they domestic goats?
Nobody knows. Just somebody phoned in and said there are goats all over the tram lines at the dune.
Flipping heck. One of the wild goats. Are the wild goats in the Isle of Man, Andy? There are, aren't there? Well, is that right?
They get quite angry sometimes. I don't know about wild.
I just wanted to highlight, as you know, I'm very focused on offshore energy, Ørsted and Kroger. And it's four working days now before the government have to make a decision on whether they're going to extend Kroger's appraisal well, which could potentially be worth £2.8 billion. And my gut feel on this is that if it's good news, it'd be early, and if it's bad news, they delay, or news they're reluctant to give. So my guess is that the government, probably next week, last minute on the 31st of October, are probably going to announce that they're not going to proceed with Kroger.
Right.
And just a gut feel, could be completely wrong. And it just really infuriates me because there just seems to be a lack of political leadership, a lack of political will. And it just seems to be caught up in civil service, AG world, whose salaries we pay. And they just don't seem to be able to comprehend the significance of it.
I mean, do you read this as being the kind of ultimate in risk aversion?
No, I don't think it's risk aversion. I think it's just... no decision is the easiest decision to make.
Right.
And I did a bit of research into this previously, and I don't know if you're, because I was actually one of the guys who wanted to buy the shares and they returned the money, so I did a bit of due diligence. But back in 1995, David North and Clifford Irvin, people probably won't remember them, they, in Timwold, they actually stated categorically and made it very clear that the Isle of Man had to basically copy and paste and mirror the UK regulations to make this happen. And I think what's happened is, or what's going to happen, is that the government over here and the AG should refuse to do that. And they're going to say, we have to apply Manx rules and regulations. That's the only thing I can think of it, of the holding this up, because the North Sea transition approved, all the due diligence is done. What possible reasons could there be? But I'm just, 4 days to go, no news to me is not good news. It's going to be bad news. That's my gut feeling. And I just think it's an absolute, travesty. And it shows, and in the meantime, they're just talking about who, lack of confidence in the Chief Minister, squabbling amongst themselves. And they're letting the civil service run rings around them. There's just no leadership, Andy.
Well,
anyway, I just wanted to get that off my chest.
It's interesting, and the point you make is very, it's apposite. I mean, it's interesting because, of course, you will never be wrong if you do nothing. A man will never ever, or a woman will never be wrong. If you do nothing, that's the easiest way to be right, if you like. But the trouble is, the implications of this could be enormous.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And they rely on people forgetting about it. In 2 or 3 weeks, there'll be a bit of a storm and go, oh, isn't that awful? And the civil service blob rely on that people's memories are short and they'll move on to the next topic, whatever that is. But it's time and time again, there's lots and lots of decisions that have been made on the Isle of Man and no decisions being made. I think we know people have come to the Isle of Man, and they maybe, let's say, wealthy individuals want to do things, and the civil servants have just said no. But on this particular occasion, they've got very little wiggle room, and I think they're going to say no because the easiest decision is to say no. And as you say, if you say no, there's no fault, and they'll move on.
So what's the worst that could happen if they said yes? If they said yes, yeah. Go ahead. What's the worst that could happen?
There isn't a downside, Andy. I'm exposed slightly because I'm sort of in terms of this world, because I'm in the offshore shipping world, so I know a bit about this. There's no downside, Andy. You know, if the Isle of Man government mirror the North Sea Transition Authority rules and regulations, the rig comes in. They're basically, if you're going to build a building, you look at this. If you're going to build a building, you need building regulations. Without the building regulations, you can't build, you can't get finance. It's as simple as that. So if the Isle of Man government mirror the North Sea Transition Authority rules and regulations, the rig comes in, they drill a test hole. It's a yes or no decision. Can the gas flow commercially or can it not? Yes or no. If it's a no, no loss to the Isle of Man. Kroger have raised 32 million, whatever they say they need to raise, and they sail away. If the answer is yes, then it moves on to phase two, and the potential is you've got a valuable asset at that point, which is worth 500 million, I think, at that point. And then with a 3D seismic, you can estimate whether it's going to be a larger field, and as Kroger have said, it could be 2.8 billion. There's no downside to this, and this is caught up in civil servants and the AG. I've got no doubt about it, Andy. No doubt about it. They're just afraid to make a decision, and there's no political leadership to say, you know what, we should move ahead with this. I understand what you're saying, civil service AG. We should mirror the North Sea Transition Authority, as was done in 1995. The precedent was set by David North, who was responsible for extending the territory award, as you probably remember as well. This is an absolute travesty, an opportunity lost. If they don't do it, and my gut feeling is they're not going to do it.
Okay. All right, Mark, we appreciate that.
Andy,
thanks for calling
care.
Today.
Cheers.
Good to hear from you. 14 minutes past 12. Do you think we need the spirit of David North and Clifford Irving to get behind this? In case you haven't noticed, by the way, Braddon's now back to normal. Braddon is back to normal. The one-way restrictions are lifted, so everything is now fine there. Apparently, at the Doon, they're feral goats. There's signs at Bulgan to look out for goats, says Texter 535. Regarding the goats, says Phil, around the Doon there are herds of wild goats, rather like the wallabies, and it's time something was done about them. They harbour ticks, which endanger lambs, and apparently the goats are, how can I put this, endlessly multiplying, let's say. A goat will eat anything, and a friend of mine tried planting an orchard around there, only to find the goats munch them to such a state that he gave up and took the trees out. By the Doon Cafe, trees have been planted, which may be goat-proof with all the netting around them, but usually they just stand on their hind legs to eat anything, i.e. the new leaf growth, and of course that will kill the tree eventually. We need a cull of the wild goats at the Doon, says Phil. And again, 0099 says, as far as I'm aware, the goats on the tram lines are wild, says that text. The wild goats have been there for years, says Julie. There are goat signs to warn you. And again, lots more people. 532 says they're feral goats, full of ticks and diseases, damaging fences for years now. Hey-ho. 532, thanks for that. The goats around the Doon are wild on the tram lines most mornings, says Chris. And again, 690 says the goats are a wild herd. They frequently are seen around that area in question, says Chris in the north. And David's with us now. Hi, David.
Hi, Randy. I just want to talk about Chris Thomas. And I can't remember what this party is called. It's got three members in it, isn't it? It's Christian.
The Rebel Alliance.
What's it called? Sorry.
The Rebel Alliance.
Well, what's that sort of title if Chris Thomas wants to be the Chief Minister? What does that give us as an island? And I just put it out to people there. I'm not in each of the constituencies who maybe, that definitely up, not up north or central Douglas there, is what do we want in a Chief Minister? Do we want a Chief Minister that can actually put us team together. He may struggle all the time with the players he's got in the team. If you look at like a football team there, you put your best players into position, don't you? You put the goalkeeper could be the Treasury Minister and stuff like that. And don't forget, the Chief Minister is our representative to the Crown and also the British Islands conferences, where they meet other Chief Ministers right around the island, right around Britain.
Yeah.
And they have a direct contact with them. So we need a Chief Minister. And I'm saying we're better to know Alf. I'm no great fan, but I look at the scenario there where Thomas is running us down a cul-de-sac where there's no entrance to get out. And if you look at the people who are on the island want to be have businesses on the island, you look at the stability, you look at what's going on. And maybe if Thomas gets it, we should have a national election again. And I would certainly call for that, because they're not unhappy with the council minister and the chief minister, but they're unhappy with all of the politicians that we've got, and most of them who don't do anything for their money.
You see, a lot of the public, and I've had lots of messages about this, they obviously know there's political opportunism, and people are, how can I put it, try to climb the greasy pole. But, I mean, do you think the members of Keys understand what the feeling is out there? There is a feeling of discontent. It may manifest itself in being against the chief minister, but that's just the outlet for it. That's not the cause. That's a symptom.
No. Yeah, and the population out there looking at their Keys members to say, what have you done for us? Yeah, halfway through a term or three quarters of the way through a term now, what have you done for the community? How have you helped the community? How have you, I keep saying all the time, the ones that keep throwing stones in a pond to make a ripple, instead of getting their sleeves rolled up and getting in there. And the Chief Minister was quite correct in putting David Ashford and Chris Thomas in there. So what were their delegated functions? Does Chris Thomas suddenly say, oh, I'm not playing this game. I want to be the Chief Minister. And he's threw his hat in the ring.
Yeah.
And I'd say to Thomas, keep your hat on, mate. You need it for another day.
No, I mean, again, David, you've been in Keys, so you will understand this. And again, this is something that people in the outside world, if it were, don't quite understand. You can still deal with somebody on a political level whilst not liking them. You don't have to be affectionate. You can dislike somebody and still work with them in politics.
I remember years ago, Tony Brown, great Chief Minister, Alan Bell, another one, different chief ministers such, and both of them actually talked to members. Members could have access to the chief minister. You could come and talk. I remember talking to Tony Brown a little while ago now, regarding when the Douglas Corporation wouldn't play ball with the bowl. And I remember Tony Brown saying, do you think some of your lads would support us if we compulsory purchase the bowl? And I remember the debate at the time. We only had to give notice. And that was the biggest asset we've got. Look at it now. It may be a little bit untidy now and again when people are wandering around there. I think it is. And we need to look at certain things there. But we moved forward on things. We had a consensus. But all I see is some of the politicians now want to score points instead of getting their sleeves rolled up, getting in there and saying, I can do that job, or I can help with that job and help that department push things forward and make life better for the rest of us.
Okay.
That's what we're at.
All right. Have a good weekend. Thanks for calling.
Bye.
All right. 25 past 12. Yes, Chris Thomas has thrown his hat into the ring already to pitch to be Chief Minister. Since being sacked from his ministerial role last year, Douglas Central MHK Chris Thomas has formed a rebel alliance with two other colleagues, Onken's Julie Edge and the Douglas South MHK Claire Christian. Chris Thomas says it's time for change.
I don't play the person in politics. I do the right thing for the future of public policy and the use of public reserves to provide things that the public need and want. And so it is true, I've been very critical of many of the Treasury policies over the last few years. The way I see it as a purist, it's government which comes out of the House of Keys after an election that should be setting the priorities in the light of what the people have told the politicians at the elections. And at the moment, it seems to me we've got Treasury running the show. Treasury's got officers embedded in all the departments that tell the departments what they might get funding for and what they might not get funding for. And I want to go back to the time when we had a national government programme spending our precious public reserves where we needed to do it according to an election.
Presumably, you're going to declare your candidacy, presuming that a vacancy existed for Chief Minister?
Well, at this moment, in an electoral cycle, coming into the fourth year, experience is going to matter, because what we need now is we need to fix the problems that need to be fixed urgently, and we need to set out clearly the options that exist for fundamental things like energy strategy, national insurance, pensions, so much more, housing, clearly, so that the election can help us make the bold, big decisions that we need to make. So yes, I am a candidate, because in the same way that I didn't vote for either of the chief minister candidates back in 2021 because there weren't clear policy direction on the table, I am available now. And if I was to have my colleagues to need me and for the people to need a politician like me, somebody who's with my sort of attention to detail, forensic analysis, laying out costed funded options for 2 years up until the election to make sure the 2026 election is better than the 2021, it would be my privilege to serve.
Chris Thomas, MHK, has said he'd like to be Chief Minister. Obviously, this motion of no confidence, and it's going to be sorted out next Tuesday. Of course, you'll be able to hear it live on Manx Radio, AM 1368. Do you have any thoughts on this? Text, email, call, and WhatsApp. And anything else on the goats?
Hello, this is Doug Farragher. In conjunction with Manx Radio, I'd like to invite you to join us and learn something about our native Gaelic tongue, the language of man.
Ah, with EPS Coatings.
Your house could be looking as good as the day it was painted for 10 years, guaranteed.
Whatever the Manx weather brings.
The revolutionary Protex system from EPS Coatings. Ultimate protection for your home. Guaranteed for 10 years. Book now for next spring and get 10% off. And keep your house beautiful for longer. Call EPS on 627 191.
We interrupt this broadcast to inform all our listeners about the huge range of bathrooms and showers on display at Pacesetter. Yes, you all know that Pacesetter is known as the island's largest tile store, but I'm here to tell you that their bathroom displays are truly inspirational. Visit Pacesetter on Harris Terrace, where you'll discover a fabulous collection of stylish bathrooms. There's something to suit everyone, with design available. Pacesetter bathrooms and showers to show off about.
Walk through the Christmas wonderland at Ramsey Garden Centre for a magical range of trees, decorations, unique gifts and much more, including the widest range of indoor and outdoor lights. Christmas at Ramsey Garden Centre, open 7 days a week.
EVF, fueling the island and fueling you, with a great range of fresh foods and everyday essentials at our filling stations, and always great offers too. Ellen Vannin Fuels.
Coming up, we have another winning weekend here on Manx Radio. And this time, we're giving you the chance to win a 5-foot real Christmas tree and a set of multicoloured lights from Ramsey Garden Centre. The team there are launching their Christmas decoration extravaganza this week. And with a winter wonderland of decorations and gift ideas, they're open 7 days a week so you can shop whenever it suits you. To win, all you need to do is listen out for the winning question, which we'll ask right across the weekend. And once you've heard it, text your answer to 166 177. Make this your winning weekend with Ramsey Garden Centre and your nation station, Manx Radio.
The Man in Line with Andy Wint.
25 past 12. Bonzo's with us now. Hello, Bonzo.
Hi there. Yes, just before I talk about what I phoned in to talk about, just responding on Chris Thomas. Now, yes, as for David Quirk, criticising other MH, or criticising current MHKs, how long was David Quirk in the Keys for? What, three terms?
Go on.
No, was it three terms? I don't know. Do you know?
Off the top of my head, certainly more than one.
Yeah. Three terms. And what are his achievements from 15 years? Yes, quite. He was part of the problem and continues to attempt to be part of the problem. Chris Thomas, on the other hand, is somebody who is actually qualified and experienced enough to be chief minister, unlike the current chief minister, who believes himself to be somehow competent, but is rather deluded, I'm afraid, in that idea. Chris Thomas would be somebody like Jane Paul Wilson, who, as he was saying about the critical situation that we're now facing, we need a chief minister who is taken seriously in Whitehall and in other places. And Chris Thomas has the background, as an economist in particular, a technocrat, but somebody who actually understands the machinery of government. He was previously, of course, Minister for Policy and Reform. And, of course, understands how economies work and how the old sort of financial system works, both in a... in a local way, in the internal Manx economy, and in the greater world economy.
Interesting though, Bonzo.
Which is what gives us most of our money.
Yeah, but interesting, Bonzo. The minister, the past two ministers of policy and reform, made no difference whatsoever. Chris Robertshaw said they refused, they didn't want what he recommended, and obviously Chris Thomas didn't get very far with it because there isn't even a Minister for Policy and Reform now at all.
Well, it was Bell, I think, who created the Ministry of Policy and Reform, wasn't it?
Certainly it was before Howard Quayle, but I mean, again, the public would ask, what good's it done?
Well, I think possibly that that forming the post of policy and reform is to give the chief minister a whipping person so that they can blame them and then sack them. So, oh dear, everything's going wrong. We've put him nearest the explosion. It's his fault. Or their fault.
Yeah. I mean, do you think Chris Thomas needs to come up with some sort of manifesto, or is he just got? He's obviously got to convince the other MHKs, but I mean, how would that sit with the public?
Well, first off, I mean, he will have to come up with some form of manifesto if there is then a vacancy and then elections are opened for the post of chief minister. That's something you have to do anyway. To the Keys, but he wouldn't make that public, and it would be a public conversation in the same way as the election of MLCs is a public conversation, because it would be a conversation of the public with their MHKs representing them, and there would be an electoral representative in it.
Okay.
Whatever you want to sort of call the complicated word, of the representatives will then elect on behalf of the people who elected the representatives.
But that wasn't why you called.
No, that was not why I called. Mark's thinking about Kroger. Kroger, as far as NSTA are concerned, Nazi Transition Authority, don't exist. They're not listed on their website as any form of operator. And the piece of UK rights that they're supposed to have purchased from a bunch called Burgate, they are still not listed as the owner of that. It is Burgate who are still listed.
Well, presumably there's been some sort of merger between Burgate and Kroger, so they've done a deal whereby maybe no money's changed hand. Maybe it's just a case of equity. Who knows? But I mean, what do you think? What is the downside?
Under NSTA rules and regs, okay, there might be a slight delay in the paperwork,
yeah.
but No, that should be listed on the website, and it isn't.
Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, let's presume.
And that is the thing. In order to abide by NFT, the rules and regulations, Kroger must have their funds ready and assigned. And they don't. And also, there's the issue more broadly when it comes to the actual Kroger field itself, and the fact that it's co-located where the Alstead Wind Farm will be. Now, the Alstead Wind Farm is now recognised by UK government as a piece of significant national infrastructure. And that's why it's been granted planning permission by the Minister for Energy, Ed Miliband, for various substations, etc., to land the electricity and for cabling on the seabed. For that.
So, do you think we should bury the idea of Kroger?
Given that. There would be then issues, I think, with the amount of turbines that actually could be placed there, and also given the fact that Miliband and the Labour government have said no new exploratory licences, I can see the likelihood of that happening being low to zero.
Okay. All right, Bonzo, we appreciate it. Good to hear from you.
Okay, then. Cheers.
Thanks for that. Now, some more messages in. If the government scraps the triple lock, it could be painful for pensioners. And MHK has told me, says this anonymous correspondent, told me that scrapping the triple lock could result in a rise in pensioners to some of less than £3 per week. We've just been to Laxey to meet friends for cake and coffee. Yes, it's the subject of the loos again. The set by the harbour hasn't been cleaned since the last time we visited 3 weeks ago. My partner went to the ladies but walked out. The loos are disgusting in Laxey, so we went to the ones at the far end and they're just as bad. I wonder if the DOI or Laxey commissioners actually care about the health and hygiene risk to public, or are they just not bothered? How shameful this looks to visitors, holiday makers. Sadly, no point in contacting either as they just pass the buck. One says it's the other's responsibility. Maybe Tim Crookall should pop down and take a look and tell the public it's acceptable. It's horrible, says Francis. NEMHK, says NT, standing for the Chief Minister's position, surely should issue a manifesto relating to the position rather than simply stating, I want to do it. We need to hear that somebody's going to prioritise the decision-making and concentrate on the NHS, infrastructure, housing, Kroger, etc. And if necessary, ignore the private members' bills and distractions and get the Isle of Man back on track. Alan says the Isle of Man government's wrapped up in its green agenda rather than worrying about Kroger, which could make us a lot of money. And I vote to keep the minister, says 392, but ensure that healthcare stays for the Manx people. If you take that away, like the dentists, no national insurance payments, then we're going to be in a pickle, says 392. And Eddie's with us now on Man in Line. Hi, Eddie.
Hi, Andy. All right, mate.
Very, very good. It's Friday. I'm great.
Likewise. Somebody said that it was announced on the radio that 14 new jobs have been created at, was it £800,000?
At Manx Care, yes.
Yeah. Did I? I was on about a week ago and I pointed out some figures to you, if you remember. I gave you the population of Borough of Trafford.
Yeah.
And the amount of civil servants for that area. The amount of civil servants for that area was more or less identical to the amount of civil servants that we've got here, which, if you just do simple arithmetic, means we've got two-thirds too many here. So how on earth, working on that sort of principle, can we create 14 new jobs? It just seems absolutely ludicrous. We should be shedding, according to those figures, nearly 1,000 jobs.
Well, there were 14 new management roles. They're management roles, apparently. 800,000 pounds a total of since it was formed in 2021.
Well, we knew it would be management roles because everybody out here cries for the jobs to be given as nurses and doctors. So they give it to management. We don't need any more management. I mean, it's management we've got to get rid of, surely, because during COVID, I think one of them jobs was a COVID injection coordinator or something like that. Now, who did it before? You know, we don't, somebody did it, so we don't need somebody specially bringing in to do it. And it's something that comes every blue moon anyway. But, you know, these are things that seem to me just simple arithmetic. It's going to be so hard now because of the state of the governments in the past and present who have just created all these jobs. How are you going to get rid of them? It's going to be impossible to say to somebody, I'm sorry, but, you know, I know we give you this job, but you've got to lose it. It's, you know, to make it right, you've got to go. Why?
Laurie Hooper was on Twitter, earlier on, talking about this, saying that you have to have managers. You can't have the clinicians doing all the clerical work. You need managers to make sure the clinicians, the doctors and the surgeons and what have you, can get on with their job. Somebody's got to be sorting out the paperwork, bluntly.
Yeah, but let me put it this way, right? If it can cope in Trafford Borough, just the same, and they reckon theirs is working perfectly, but they've only got a third of what we've got. So we're overmanned somewhere along the line. And it's that, if you look at that amount of people, if we shed 1,000 jobs, say, just to marry up with a similar borough anywhere in England, right? Because it's no different. You still got to do the same jobs. How much money would be saved? It'd be millions and millions of pounds saved. But we'd be paying that in compensation now to get rid of these jobs, surely. And they've created such a bottleneck that it's going to be very hard to get rid of. Excuse me, but you know, there is nothing logical about creating another 14 jobs. It's exactly the opposite to what needs to be done, surely.
Okay. All right, Eddie.
Yeah. One thing before you go is I'd just like to congratulate Tim for calling a vote of no confidence. And I think the very best thing that could happen to the Isle of Man is to get rid of Alf Cannon, because for the last God knows how long, I can't remember one single decision he's made that's been good for the island.
Okay, all right. We appreciate your call, Eddie. Thanks for that.
Pleasure.
Good to hear from you. If Kroger is delayed, if the government delays Kroger, we could lose out to the UK. Kroger, says Pat on 223, could legally locate the rig outside Manx waters, use the directional drill methods to extract the gas, and that's that. It will be a big loss to the Isle of Man. And a message in from Marie. It's Marie who just says, I can't understand why some people are just set against Kroger. Surely if we give them the opportunity for a test rig, we'll know whether it's going to work or not. Either nothing will happen and we haven't lost anything, or something will happen and we'll get money into the Manx treasury. What are these people missing? Here's a message in, just as said, if the government scraps the triple lock again, painful to pensioners, it's going to be a small rise. And a message in, just say, I vote to keep the minister. If chief minister is Chris Thomas, there will be no gas field drilling for Kroger. Chris Thomas was the stumbling block when Minister of Infrastructure, and with his green agenda, he will bankrupt the Isle of Man, says 980. Well, that's 980's opinion. You may have a different opinion, in which case you're more than welcome to voice it. Text, email, call and WhatsApp. And a message in just says, again, if there are goats at the dune, they're probably wild. They live in the area. I never knew there was a colony of wild goats in the dune. I mean, I've seen them seen stuff, we know one or two, but I didn't know, whereabouts do they live? Who's their MHK? Was Chris Thomas not the original DOI minister in charge of the promenade and the Liverpool Sea Terminal, says B? Wasn't it Chris Thomas's policies that built our cycle paths to nowhere on the Peel Road and the repurposed bridge, Pullrose Bridge, a waste of public money, says B? I'm vexed, says Jeff, with the prospect of Chris Thomas getting anywhere near the chief minister role. I'm a declared pro-Kroger drilling man with a background in energy services. We need Kroger's test appraisal well drilled and answer on its economic viability. Drilling the well doesn't let the genie out of the bottle. It gives you a result that allows an informed discussion in Tynwald. Chris Thomas has and is doing his best to get the well drilling stalled, preferring to embrace renewable energy. It will be the biggest mistake in modern times if this appraisal well is not drilled. No thanks, Mr. Thomas, says Jeff. Text, email, call, WhatsApp. The Kroger, I mean, is it such a big problem to just let them drill an appraisal well? Is it, I mean, really, is it such a problem? Because we'll know whether it happens or not. And you would have thought that Kroger and the government can get their heads together and sort it out. I mean, really, what is the problem? Is somebody somewhere not saying we don't trust Kroger? By just saying, you know, it's this, it's that, it's regulations, it's this, that, and the other, or Ed Miliband's having a bad day, whatever it is. Is it just that these people simply don't trust Kroger, but just don't say it? And Dick says it was Alan Bell who sent back in 2016 then Health Minister Howard Quayle and Mark Charters, DHSC chief executive, to New Zealand for 3 weeks to look at the health service there, which led to the idea of having the same thing here with Manx Care. Alan Bell's government. They're the ones that authorised it in the first place. If the Manx Grand Prix, says Bob, is going to run for 2 weeks next year, where are Manx Care going to get all that extra money from, says Bob. And we've got Chris with us now. Oh, hi, Chris. Chris Robertshaw, former MHK.
Hi, Andy. Andy, here I am again, ringing up again. Reference Bonzo's strange statements about, oh, Kroger's not on the NST website. Well, the fact of the matter is, if he bothered to check some of these things he comes up with, he would find it takes 10 days to lodge these sort of things with the NSTA, and that process is going on at the moment. But the insinuation on Bonzo's part that was somehow something not proper in all of this. I mean, I really do wish that if he's going to come onto the radio and spout his opinions, that he checks his facts. Now, last time I rang you, I gave my number in public, so that if Bonzo wanted to talk about Kroger, he would first please check to see whether he's talking sense or not. And he's simply not. And I do wish he'd resist from this business of spouting off information that's intended to mislead the public. It's just not right.
So why do you think, Chris, why are some people dead set against Kroger, and why it seems as though some people simply don't trust this idea? Why is that?
Well, I think it's very simple. I think it tends to come from those who don't understand that the transition from fossil fuels to green energy is quite a process and will take many, many years. And Kroger is part of that transitionary service. That gas is part of that, and it's going to remain a very important part for many years to come. But the closed mind, the sort of more zealot, extreme ideological people who think that we can convert tomorrow over to full green energy are massively mistaken. And I'm afraid that mindset is currently too influential. And just for the record, did Chris Thomas act as supportive and an appropriate minister of DOI with regard to Kroger when he was in post? The answer is no, he wasn't. And that was manifested afterwards. And since he was removed from DOI, it showed that he kept putting questions into Keyes and Simwald about Kroger. The intention on his part was to insinuate, like Bonzo just did then, that there's something wrong. Well, this process is all about undermining an operation that's trying to do the right thing for the Isle of Man, to assist in future significant incomes, trying to be undermined by those who simply think that tomorrow or the day after we can move away from fossil fuels. Well, those people need to understand that if we rush our fences, we're in danger of causing all sorts of problems to ourselves, and it's not a world I sort of want to be part of.
I mean, is it really possible that political dogma could hobble Kroger so that it doesn't, pure political dogma, not reason, not scientific fact, but political dogma?
Yes, absolutely it is, yeah. Absolutely.
And how do you feel about that?
Well, how do I feel for the Isle of Man? My God. I mean, look, we're in a situation now where we're facing the possibility of increased taxes or the need to reduce the size of government significantly. And are we going to do both or either of those two things? What we really need right now is security of energy at a sensible price, a significant new income for the exchequer so that that whole process can help the Isle of Man through the next 10 to 15 years, both in transitionary terms and indeed in making sure our services to the public are right and paid for, and we keep our reserves. You remember, you've heard the issues in recent days from the Treasury Minister about the NI fund running out and that my grandchildren and children may not have pensions in the future. These are really, really serious, important issues, and unfortunately, some people are not thinking this through properly, and it's a real worry. I'm getting on now. I'm not really interested in myself at all. As many people of my age are, we're interested in what's going to happen to the Isle of Man. And Andy, I'm worried with the way things are going.
Okay. All right, Chris, we appreciate your call. Thanks for that. Good to hear from you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
All right, 12 minutes to one.
I began to struggle with the stairs, but I didn't want to leave our family home. So my daughter told me about Acorn Stairlifts and their new showroom in Douglas. I was able to try the stairlifts and find the right one for me and the home I love. They were so friendly. The whole process was hassle-free and they offered the whole package from installation to servicing. Choose the island's first choice for stairlifts. Acorn Stairlifts, South Quay, Douglas.
Call Acorn Stairlifts now on 672-414 or call into our Douglas showroom.
It's a tough time for businesses. Not sure what to do to turn things around? Let Nicola Bowker & Co. guide you through. We've helped hundreds of businesses to success. Accountants and tax advisors to businesses on the Isle of Man.
Whatever your style, you'll find something stunning to enhance your home at Millar Chaps of Ramsey. From classic elegance to new trends in home design, Millar Chaps have two fabulous floors packed with fantastic furniture, furnishings and homeware. Whether you're looking for fabrics and wallpapers, new flooring, a comfy sofa or unique artwork, you'll find it at Millar Chaps, with autumn promotions and special offers throughout the store right now. Find your style on offer today at Millar Chaps of Ramsey.
Do you know a scrap man? Cos I've got scrap to clear. Causing call for press and lead, and I need cash for beer.
What? You don't know a scrap man? Gustains of Foxhall is the one for you. Gustains will take all scrap metal and is also licensed to dry sell and lead acid batteries. So don't delay. Ring 801-337 now.
So now we know a scrap man and all our scrap's been cleared. Ring 801-337, then have cash for beer. Call Cost Dice today and get yourself a beer.
The Man in Line with Andy Wint.
10 to 1 after Man in Line today. We're back in 1990. It's our 60th anniversary. Did you know that? It is. And every Monday and Friday, we look back into the archive. Today, we're at 1990's Thanksgiving service at St. Thomas Church in Douglas for the 90th anniversary of the Gaiety Theatre when Man in Line finishes today. Howard's on now. Hi, Howard.
Hello, Andy. Chris Robertshaw, it's good to hear an honest voice. He was never high on my Christmas card list, but he's a man that talks a lot of sense. And what I was thinking about, even just before he came on, with the delays and delays and procrastinations that we've had through the government, we're getting to a point now with Kroger where the UK government, the Labour government, coming into power, and with that, well, I've got a word for him, but I'll call him Ed Miliband. He has this idea that he's going to stop everything in fossil fuels. And even if they are successful in Kroger, find gas. BP, I think it was, they were there many years ago, and they said there was gas there, but whether it was at that time financially viable to take out of the ground. We hope it is. It could provide money for the Alaman government. But if Ed Miliband has his way, and he's already made this promise to stop all new licenses, he won't be able to stop this one, I don't think. But he will interfere with the purchase or the sale of the gas. Where will the gas go to? Because it wouldn't be coming ashore here. It'll be going to the UK. And if he's that much opposed to any fossil fuels, by the time this particular well, if it comes on stream, he could be in a dictatorial form and stop any sale of gas to the UK. It seems just a silly idea, but the way the UK government is working at the present moment, it's a strong possibility. Because they've got this green sheen, and this is what they want to do. They want to go down the road of everybody with a pylon, and then it's going to go back to the 1970s, where we're having a three-day week and blackouts. So, but that is to say, listen carefully to Chris Robertshaw. He does. He's a man that talks a lot of sense. He has a business acumen. He was involved with the Sefton Hotel, as we know, built it up into a good hotel on the promenade, still going strong. And, you know, these are the people we want in government.
So how would you feel? I mean, how would you feel? Because Chris Robertshaw's suggestion is that Chris Thomas is dead against Kroger. Now, if he's pitching to be chief minister, we don't stand a hope in hell of it ever happening then.
No. Well, I've thought that myself, that Chris Thomas, again, an intelligent man, but his bias is towards the green scene. And this is where they're going to stop. And they've just put little things in the road that need to be debated. And then they'll put something else and the filibuster, and they'll just go on and on and on to such a time where it won't become feasible.
Okay, all right, Howard, we appreciate it. Have a good weekend.
Take care. Bye now.
6 minutes before one. My brother, Les Neil, lived in the Doon for many years, used to shoot the occasional goat. Since he died in 2019, says Muriel, nobody seems to have taken over this unofficial role. The feral goats are multiplying. Another message came in and said, we'll put a goat in charge as chief minister, then we'll have a real nanny state. It's true. Oh, watch out. Pupils travelling home by bus from school will have an hour less to use their bus pass from next month. SCH1 and SCH2 will only be valid until 5 o'clock from the 4th. That's next week instead of 6 o'clock. That's it. Out of hours, 682-631 on the answer phone. maninline@manxradio.com. Back with the Chief Minister and the Chief Constable on Monday. Russ Foster will be on Man in Line.
W-I-N-T.
60 years serving you as the nation station. This is Manx Radio.
The Gaiety Theatre, Frank Matcham's marvellous design, was completed in 1900. What a way for Douglas to start that new century. In those days, they did things in style. In 1990, a service of thanksgiving for the theatre was held and broadcast on Manx Radio.
I welcome you all most warmly to St Thomas's for this service of thanksgiving. Your presence in such numbers this afternoon is an indication that the Gaiety Theatre, now celebrating its 90th anniversary, is not lacking in friends. It was St. Thomas Aquinas who said, without a friend, thou canst not live well.
We're delighted to have with us here this afternoon the patron of the Friends of the Gaiety, His Excellency the Lieutenant Governor, together with Lady New, and also the President of the Friends, Air Marshal the Reverend Sir Patterson Fraser and Lady Fraser. And how grateful we are to those who will be assisting our Thanksgiving with song and speech and organ music. Molly Sugden, Linda Watterson, Ethel Brooks, Marion Norris, Jack Douglas, Harry Galbraith, and John Riley. And how very good it is to see, too, the present staff of the Gaiety and former manager Fred Barwell. So let our service of praise and thanksgiving proceed now without any further announcement from me, as we sing the hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing, Alleluia.
For 60 years, this is your Manx Radio.